Hello energy transition fans. In this series of videos, we're going to take an in-depth look at tin, a metal that doesn't get too much attention from investors, but is likely to be incredibly significant to the energy transition. Tin is an important metal used in long-standing industrial processes such as tin solder, tin-based chemicals, tin plating, and lead-acid batteries. But tin is also an important component in the move away from fossil fuel-based energy, through its use in wind power, solar panel, and batteries for electric vehicles. Despite this wide variety of uses and potential growth in the demand for tin through the energy transition, the supply side of the market is fairly constrained, with China accounting for over 50% of production and a limited pipeline of growth projects in the market. In this video, we're going to start by looking at the different types of tin deposit. Now, depending on how you classify tin deposits, there are upwards of 15 different categories. And just to make things really easy for us, each tin deposit can contain multiple types of different mineralization. So in this video, I'm going to keep things simple. I have defined five main types of tin deposit that fit the peer group we'll examine in later videos. And I classify each deposit based on the dominant type of tin mineralization present. So let's have a look at the ultra-realistic high-definition model that we've prepared. First up, we can see our country rock, i.e. the rock into which our tin mineralization will form a deposit. For this video, I've kept it simple with sedimentary rocks, but tin deposits can form in other rock types too. Into our country rock comes the igneous intrusion. Normally granitic in composition, this molten mass of hot rock is normally both the source of the tin metal and also the provider of the heat and fluids required to form the deposit. The first type of tin deposit we will look at are veins and stockworks, here shown in pale blue. During the final stages of the intrusion cooling, tin is one of the last metals to drop out of the solution due to its low melting point. So compared to its original composition, the cooled intrusion is tin depleted and the remaining fluid is tin enriched. At the very end of the intrusion's cooling process, the remaining fluids can be injected into areas of weakness at high pressure to form veins and stockwork. The next type of deposits are grisons, shown here in green. Grisons represent the very last of the fluid from the cooling magma, which pools above the intrusion and is injected back into the cooled igneous intrusion to form a thin network of vuggy quartz veins and tin-rich veins. Tin pegmatites, shown here in red, form earlier in the cooling process, and veins and stockworks and grisons. When the tin-rich liquid rock or magma is injected into the country rock in various shapes and orientations. Skarns, shown in yellow, are also formed during the waning stages of the cooling process, when tin-rich fluids are injected into and react with a carbonate-bearing host rock. This is a process called metasomatism, and this forces the tin to precipitate. The last deposit type we will look at in this video series are tailings deposits. Now, these are secondary tin deposits formed from the processing waste of previous operations, so they don't appear in this diagram. Thanks very much for watching. Next week, we're going to look at the grade and tonnage distribution of different tin types. You can follow me on LinkedIn and Twitter, and you can download all our research for free from our website.